Hi everybody, I'm Cassie, also known as Crafty Cassie here on YouTube, and that's about it. But I do have a Ravelry group now. That is something new starting this episode, and I will be posting the show notes there. So, if you are a returning viewer, it's been a while and I apologize. It's been a really long time, and I've missed you guys so much, and thank you for returning. For those of you that are new and you haven't seen any of my other podcasts, welcome to my longest episode ever. So I'm going to dive into some things. I'm not going to do blather just yet. I'm going to put that at the end, but I'm going to give you a reason why I've been gone. So I'm back from Disneyland vacation. Fabulous trip. I have some yarn that I got there that I will show you. I think I have it here. I then had to rush to get my stuff packed up to do my overseas travel, that kind of travel training, kind of both, for my work. That happened really fast. I recorded an episode before I left for Disneyland and I never got it uploaded, and so I just decided that because it's been such a big gap between the two, between recording and putting up, I figured I'd scrap it. Anyways, with that being said, I do have everything I think. No, I don't have a hat that I finished on that episode. My husband took that with him because now he is on overseas work. So, yeah. Anyways, so I went and did that for 6 weeks, came home, and then everything's kind of just been a whirlwind. I was at work for a week, and then I went to a summer camp for children who were burned, the Camp Phoenix. I was a counselor there, and it was so much fun. I loved it. I did it from Friday until the following Saturday, so a week, like 8 days. It was crazy. It was awesome. I loved it. I got thrown in the lake. I'll talk more about that in the blather section, but yeah, it was great. So that's where I've been. And then I actually took my husband to the airport while I was at camp, so thankfully that was early enough in the morning that it didn't interfere with any of the activities with the kids. What else? And then we've been taking care of some personal things here at home, which again I'll take care of in blather. There's just been so much going on in these last 2.5 months, almost three, all of July, all of August, part of June, and it's now the second week of September. So yeah, I want to say 2.5, almost 3 months actually. I do apologize for that massive gap. I did kind of warn you, for those that have seen part of my other episodes, that my overseas training for work was coming up. I just didn't think that so much was going to happen in such a short time period. So I'm just going to jump into it. I kind of have a mixture of works in progress and finished objects and half-finished objects. So I'm just going to grab and start with what's in my lap because it's heavy and it's hot. So let's see if I can get up. There, this is all of it. This is actually the start of a chunky monkey Afghan for my husband. What did I do with the wrappers? I brought them. Oh, there they are. So, this is, it's just a double crochet stitch back and forth. There's nothing special to the stitch. I'm just changing a color, the blue, in there just to kind of add interest stripes. So this is Lion Brand Yarns Wool Ease Thick and Quick, and this is in the colorway Oatmeal. So that's the front. And that's the color. This is a chunky weight. That's why I call it a chunky monkey. Yes, it's the number 6 super bulky. And my, you know, I wanted something super bulky for my husband because it's more plush, more warmth, but it's not going to be stifling hot, which because of the stitch, there's such big, you know, there's some holes in the blanket. He loves the colorways, he loves the yarn, and I'm crocheting it on a USN or a 10 millimeter hook. It's a chunky monkey. So this blanket's gonna get big. I do have one more ball of the oatmeal. This is what I have left from that blue stripe earlier. This is the acai color, same yarn. We got it off Amazon. My husband, we have Amazon Prime, so we order a lot from them, actually. So I'm just gonna keep going and keep going and keep going. He'll definitely have it before Christmas. Hopefully I'll have it done by the time he gets home. But we are moving, so my projects are gonna go on hiatus here for a couple weeks at the end of this month. So, sadly, but hopefully I'll have it done by the time he gets home, which is in November. Throw that down there. Okay, so then, let's see here. I picked up, where'd I go? Oh, so I went up to my favorite yarn store, local to me, Northwest Yarns, or, Northwest Handspun Yarns. They're changing their name. They've got new owners. So, yeah. They're located in Bellingham, Washington, which is about an hour drive north of me. And I went and I rented a spinning wheel. So, on that spinning wheel, I spun up this. This was some fiber I picked up at Goodwill. Something of that nature, a secondhand store, and it was just a braid of fiber that somebody just gave up. It was like $3 that I paid for it, and it's by Be Mice Elf. So, and they're on Etsy. I haven't looked to see if they're still on Etsy, but they were, and this colorway is called Frolic. Fiber content is Falkland, and it is 4.7 ounces. I really liked it. I really liked working with it. It has a very, very long steeple length, so I got it pretty thin. I haven't plied it yet. It's only in its singles weight right now. I do plan on plying it, but I think I'm going to wait a minute to ply it. I'm going to because I did put down a down payment on my own spinning wheel. I'm just renting this in the meantime. So I'm thinking that I want to find like a shoebox or something of that nature that I can then put a straight knitting needle through and turn it into a lazy Kate, and then I might ply it because I tried plying without a lazy Kate and that sucked. I may also wait until I can afford to buy a nice lazy Kate off Amazon. I'm looking at the Ashford ones. They're stand up rather than the curved type. Both are nice. I've not worked with any of them, though I have seen the curved lazy Kate in action. My drink that I'm about to take a sip of is in my Queen of Everything cup that I got off at a Walmart. And I love this Tiffany blue. It's a little brighter than what I want to paint my craft room as, but it's close. The coffee is, it is coffee. It's caramel, vanilla, something. It's a medium roast. I have regular sweet cream creamer in here and by Nestle, and then I've got a spurts of Starbucks caramel flavor pump thingy. It's really sweet, almost sickeningly sweet, but yeah. So I spun all of that up since I've been home. While I was also picking up the spinning wheel to rent, I saw that they had a new local yarn, kind of like a mini trunk show going on, and I picked up my very first sock blank. And they do come in two halves. So here's the other half. They were cut in half. So this is what it looks like. Just beautiful rainbowy colors. And it's sparkly. There we go. Get some glimpses of that glitziness. This is the Stardust blank. It is 75% superwash merino, 20% nylon, and 5% stellina. There are 436 yards, or 100 grams. There is another sticker in here. Wool. Oh. Well, I found out where they bought the sock blank from. This is in the colorway Arcade. I don't know the brand of the yarn. I don't. It's not on here anywhere. The label here called the Stardust Blank H&E. There isn't the name of the company on here. But yeah. So cute labeling. I do like that label. I just wish they would have put their name on there as well. Title of the company, and then the Stardust blank. That would have been helpful for those of us like me who had a brand fart, name fart, if you will. So with that, I've taken one half. This is all I have left of the first half of that sock blank. It's quite a bit left, actually. And I knit a sock. Yes. So it's all done, cast off. Just a Wollen Vines favorite sock pattern, one and a half inch cuff, 4 inch, possibly 5 inch leg. I think I did a 5 inch leg. And then just a regular partridge heel, decreases, toe, Kitchener stitch, blah, blah, blah. It does fit awesome. It does need to be soaked and blocked. I don't have sock blocks for my size yet, so that's not done yet. And I do have to knit the second sock. This was also on US 2.5s or 2.75 needles. They're carbons. So that needs to be done. Another project that I have started, and it's going very nicely, actually. Is this guy? Isn't he cute? So this is... What is this? Let me pull up my Ravelry page. Because I put it in my library. Load faster. But anyways, I'll talk about this while this is loading. I want to say this is the Super Sweet Sweater pattern. I looked up the, here we go. My notebook. Library. Okay. I'm doing this on US 5s or, what is it? millimeter needles. The pattern calls for US 4s, but it also calls for fingering weight yarn. And it's also for a 3 to 6 month old baby. I'm trying to knit this for my nephew, Kalen. And he is already in 6 month old clothing, so and we still have, and he's 4 months old, And I wanted to give him this for Christmas, which means that he's probably going to be in 9 to 12 month old clothing, if not 12 to 18 month old clothing at that age. Just because he's grown so fast. He's a solid 19 pound baby at 4 months old. So he's tall, he's chunky, he's happy, and teething. He has one of his little side tooths over here coming in, and he's not happy right now. But he's learning his voice. I got him a little bouncy chair off of one of the buy sell trades online, and he's going crazy in it, learning about it. Mommy and Daddy are learning how to use the bouncer. So this is their first baby, and he's just a real big sweetheart. He really is. He just loves to cuddle, and as he is soon to be favorite aunt. Let's just say I has to knit him all of the things, all of the baby things, since he's the only baby that is in my life right now. Especially since my other coworker that I babysit for quite often, actually, or I used to quite often, his wife's no longer going to school during the weekday, so I don't babysit them nearly as often, but it's maybe picking up now that we're getting into full time. But his daughter has grown so much. She's a year and a half now, and she's just into everything. So she's just grown like a weed, honestly. But anyways, back to the sweater. So I thought that if I went up a yarn weight, and I actually did it wrong. I went up two yarn weights because I was supposed to use a weight size one, and I'm using a weight size three. So lace is considered a zero, fingerling is a one. I want to say Aran is a two, and DK slash sport is a three. Worsted is a four. Chunky is a five. Chunky or bulky is a five, and then super bulky is a six. So I was supposed to use a fingerling weight, which is a one. And I should have gone up to an Aran weight, but Aran weight isn't really sold at any of the local stores here in the US, at least not in the box stores. I'd have to order it off of a specialty yarn, and I didn't want to spend that much money. So what I did do though is I went to the next best thing. This is a super amazing yarn. It's super soft, super plush. I got it at Hobby Lobby. And they've got a vast range of colors. I don't necessarily support their business plan, but I do love their products. So with that being said, I am use the one that I'm not actually knitting with right now. So this is Baby B in their Sweet Delight base. And this colorway, which I used for the top of the sweater, is the Blue Baby Camo. And then what I'm using for the rest of the sweater is the same brand and base, but in the colorway Chocolate. So I also bought another duo set that's kind of like grays with some brighter vibrance in the variegation of the shoulder, because that's what the pattern calls for. Ah, here it is. It is the Sweet Baby Sweater. That's the pattern. By Caroline Wines. I just want to see. There we go. So here's what it looks like finished. So as you can see from mine, I am definitely into the body of the sweater. I'm thinking after I finish this row and I'm really close to it, I'm actually going to pin off, because I'm on interchangeable needles, pin off the cord and do the sleeves next, actually, where I'm at right now. And the reason for that is because right now I've been binge watching podcasts, knitting podcasts, and I'm halfway through the Stranded podcast by Amy Florence. She's also the knitter behind, or the dyer behind Stranded Dye Works. They're located out of UK. And she was talking about how she was watching another podcast, and I forget who it was, but go watch her earlier episodes, and she talks about it there. I want to say it was like episode 3. And it was recommended that you knit just below the armpit, like an inch. And this was more recommended for adult sweaters, but this is my first sweater knitting ever, so I'm going to try it. But to knit just like an inch below the armpit and then pick up the sleeves next so that you're not spinning all this bulk around and around and around as you're knitting the sleeves. So I like that idea. My hands, I found out while I was on my overseas travel when I was knitting, I was working on a shawl and I was knitting for hours at a time, literally, because I just had no work to do. I was there as a trained technician, but there was no work for the work that I'm qualified to work on, the gear I'm qualified to work on. So my gear was out there, it just wasn't being used, so it wasn't being broken, which means I didn't have anything to fix. So I knit a lot while I was over there. I didn't really go anywhere specifically, so I just kind of sat in my work center and knit a lot. And I found that as my work got heavier and heavier for longer periods of time, that my hands and arms, like, I had a dead arm for like 4 days in a row for several patches of time because I was working on this one particular shawl and it just got heavy really fast, which I'm actually going to be showing to you guys later on. But anyways, so I'm going to finish this row, bind it off, and then I'm going to pick up the sleeves and hopefully I'll have this sweater done by next week. That is my goal, actually. Today is Sunday and I have to be getting ready for work in a few hours. So I should be able to finish this by the time I need to start getting ready for work. We'll see though. But anyways, this is, it's a lot bigger than I intended. Yeah. It's more of, say, a 18-month-old sweater. And if it wasn't in such masculine colors, I'd probably be giving this to Ava instead of Kaylin. But blues and browns, she is definitely a girly girl, so that's probably not something she's going to want to wear very much. So, yeah. Alright, so that is everything that is on my desk that I've been working on since I've been home. So I'm going to grab the bag. I left 2 projects in my lunch bag and 2 completed objects on my nightstand. I'm going to go grab those actually real quick and talk about them now because it's either I'd be cutting out me bending down to pick up the bag or I'd be cutting out whatever. So anyways, I'm going to go do that real quick. Alrighty, so I'm back. Completed objects because they're easy to show and they're simple. They're cute. Ends aren't sewn in as usual, but that's okay. So I have one little baby cap. It'll probably have to be worn. Dion. I may, after I finish the one hat I'm on, I may just add a couple more rows to here so that they can be rimmed, because it's a little on the narrow side, a little on the short-sighted. I didn't realize that. So that's another baby hat. And this little cutie. This is all the same yarn, by the way. So I got a lot of variation. It's not multiple yarns, I promise. So that's second. And I'm currently working on the third. So, yes. So there's that. This is, what yarn is this? This is Loops and Threads Snuggly Wuggly Dip Dye in the colorway Daffodils. I'm using a size, a USF hook or a 3.75 millimeter hook. I just kind of do this at night when I want something easy to work on, and I don't really have to think too much about it. Like I can crochet without looking, honestly. So it's, I've been crocheting for so long that I, you learn how to do it. Then, here's another project I've been working on. Yes! So I have this finished one of these in my bag down below. I'd actually brought this with me on my overseas travel, overseas work. And I didn't work on this. I meant to, but I never got to. This is all I have left. This is Ba Yarns in the London Blue colorway. I got this in my Fiberista Club subscription a while ago. I know I did talk about this on the podcast, so I decided, I dared a coworker of mine to, because I work in electronics, and when it gets a power surge, it will sometimes blow the power supplies that are internal to the gear. And one of those connectors was completely fried and disgusting, and it smelled burnt. And ugh. So anyways, dared him to lick it. He said no, because he has a baby that he has to think of. I was like, okay. Well, one of my other coworkers was like, wait, is that, you know, is that dare up for grabs? And I was like, sure, if you lick it, I'll make you a pair of socks. So that happened. And I am now knitting him a pair of socks. And I showed him these Thursday of last week, and he loves them. He has really big feet, too. He wears a size 13. So I'm hoping I have enough yarn here. This is the biggest needle size that Volunfine suggests for her socks, or Kristen of Volunfine Yarns suggests for her sock pattern. I actually had him trace his foot, actually, and I took the measurements of how far I needed to knit for the foot based on that. So I usually knit up until about the bend of the pinky toe, and that was 9.5 inches. But I also have a fairly loose gauge, so I only did 8.5. I know I can probably block out another 1/2 inch from the foot, which will get me up to 9, and then the toe ended up actually being almost 2 inches. Like, it was 1/8 of an inch short of 2 inches. Might have been more, I can't remember. It's been a while since I knit that sock. But anyways, I do have some scrap yarn left over from my mother-in-law's socks. So if I run out of blue yarn for the foot of this one, I'm going to frog back at least the toe of the other sock, so that I'll have enough for this one, and I will put the toe in with, I thought I'd put this on silent. There. That's on silent. Anyways, So that's what I'm planning on doing because I am playing Yarn Chicken as of right now on this sock. Oh, the needles I am using are US ones. This had it printed on the needles themselves, but it's rubbed off because it was just, ink printed. It wasn't actually stamped into the wood. So whatever US ones are, quick Google search, I'm sure I'll find it and put it into the show notes. With that said, so that is this one. The sock. Next thing to talk about, that I have to talk about, I should say, is a finished object. This is the infamous hitchhiker shawl. And honestly, I could have made this longer. It's an asymmetrical shawl. I'll be wearing more as like a scarf. The yarn I actually got while I was down in Portland on my way to Disneyland. So this is a local hand-dyed yarn to them. If I find it, because it's in the bottom of the bag. I'm actually now starting to pull stuff out of my bag from my overseas travel. Ooh, that's hot. Where I'm at my house is in my bedroom. You can kind of see from the bed. And I have to keep it pretty hot in here because of my hedgehog. She's here. Last night we had some great bonding time, by the way. So that was nice. But anyways, I followed the pattern for the most part. I want to say I knit 35 spikies, 35 repeats of the pattern, and got the length that I'm at right now. So I do need to sew in the ends and block it. It'll probably be much bigger once it's been blocked, though. So sorry about that. I'm just gonna grab the bag. So it's the bag I won from when I did the yarn tour of all my LYSs. They do it every year here for the Pacific Northwest. Well, I should say the it's not the peninsula, though we have a shop on the peninsula. Not many though. The inlet. I guess that's what you would call the body water here in Washington State. Yes, so it's just along the inlet there. So Seattle, up all the way up to the US Canadian border. There were some shops in there, Linden, and as far south as Tacoma. Yeah, there wasn't many shops in Tacoma, even though there's like five or six shops in Tacoma. Only one or two of the Tacoma shops actually participated in it. But anyways, so everything I took with me into my overseas work is in this bag. So one project I finished while I was on the boat were these. And these are some of Volunvine's favorite sock pattern, the vanilla socks. They're for my husband. I didn't knit the foot long enough, so I have to rip the toes out and recast these on. Actually, I'm gonna block these because there's still quite a bit of stretch and see if I can get these to be the size that he needs. So they were just short by like quarter of an inch. So I may be able to get that to block out since it is just so little of size. So block those instead. Grab this pattern because it's right on. Hey, here's the leftover of that shawl. And grab this guy. I am working on the lace section. Okay. So here it is. Unfortunately, I no longer have my note 4, so it's going to be a pain in the butt to try and remember how many, where I'm at in the pattern. But I have those pictures saved. So I am on, I pulled this out completely, and I have done how many? 1, 2, and I'm on the third lace chunk. I think there's 5 total, and I'm in, about to start the 4th repeat of this row of the lace panel. So I've got some stitch markers marking the end of each repeat. So this is the Waiting for Rain shawl. It's on Ravelry. I want to say it's Sylvia Bobilvia is the person who made it. I'm using US 6s or 4mm needles. The yarn is Madeline Tosh Merino Lights, or Merino Light. It's a single ply fingerling weight. And this blue here, this lace color, is in the colorway Ink. And then the garter stitch is in this beautiful brown and blue variegated, same base, but in the colorway Mare. I actually just picked up another skein of Mare, which I'm going to show you because, dang it, I forgot to grab that too. It's right behind me, so it's a quick clip. Anyways, so that got all ripped out and redone. This is where I learned that when I'm knitting heavy stuff, my arm goes dead if I've been knitting for 5 and 6 hours at a time. Here's what's left of my first skein. There's not much, so that's why I bought a second one, and I still have 3 sections of garter stitch left to knit, so I wanted to make sure that I had enough. I'm actually getting into the... Here's the other song. Sock. It's actually flipped inside out. I'm gonna flip it inside right. Completed. It's not blocked. But there it is. And actually, I may have gotten more than 2 inches because that toe looks really long. But anyways, so here's the sock for my coworker, the one that's finished at least. I'm just gonna grab projects as I find them. There's all of my scrap yarn left over from all my projects. I love these socks. I can't wait to wear them. But they're going to go into my box of socks cowl first before then. So here they are. I love them. These. The yarn for my husband's socks. I knit on US 2.5 needles. And the yarn is Lorna's Laces Shepherd's Sock, which is 80% superwash merino, 20% nylon, in the October 2012 colorway Indie. This is a special hand-dyed limited edition colorway for Jimmy Bean's wool, so you can't get it anymore. Sorry, guys. But this, on the other hand, I love this colorway. This is Manos de Uruguay, del Uruguay, 75% in their... Allegra base in the colorway Candombe. There it is. My battery is actually flashing at me, so I'm going to show you guys. These are just on US 2.5s as well. Smallest stitch size that Wool and Vine suggests for socks. And that Kristen suggests for her socks, and these were like the first project I finished out there. So I have quite a bit left over. Now that I'm in a stopping position, I'm gonna go ahead and change my batteries real quick. All right, so I'm back, new battery, and I grabbed the Madeline Tosh that I bought recently. So I will show you that in a bit, actually. I'm just gonna take it. all out of the bag, all of my stash enhancements, and try and talk about those in one swoop. You've already seen this one. I just have it knit with it. And you've seen that one. Why did I bring garbage? So, then I also finished up a matching mate to the sock that I finished previously. So that is in this colorway right here, which is the premium woolless sock yarn in the Grand Canyon colorway. I knit these on US 2s. That's the body of the sock. The toes and cuffs are a Lorna's Laces, Jimmy Bean's Wool, limited edition colorway. It was their September 2012 red stripe colorways. That's not available anymore. I do have a bit of that left right here. So that's that. That sock's done. And then I started and finished another project, another set of socks, and this is it right here. And this is Lorna's Laces, another Jimmy Bean's Wool exclusive hand-dyed yarn for their September. No. Then what was that red stripe one? Maybe they dyed a couple of colors, I can't remember. But anyways, this is the September 2012 Slushy Facial colorway. And these are more favorite sock pattern by Volenvine, Kristen, on 2.5 needles on the smallest stitch count. And then I started a new project. Hold that to the side. So, yes. It's a little, anyways. This is a 3x3 square. I'm going to then edge it in a solid color, make it more of like a quilt style. Anyways, all of my pickups are kind of just wonky. They're all over the place. I do kind of like that look. It has more of a newbie feel to it. With that said, that's the first complete block of the scrap blanket, and here's the second one started. I don't think there's any yarn here that is caked up, as far as scraps go, that need to be put into the sock blanket as of right now. So that's good. I haven't finished any projects really to put into the sock blanket yet either. So I'm just working on getting a little organized here. With that said, I did cake up, this is actually, I'm gonna go into my stash enhancements and talk about it now, because there's a lot of stash enhancements, and that's it for all of my projects now. So, with that being said, I did cake up this, I showed it to you guys already before. This is Fidalgo Artisan Yarn Company. It's their Silk Shimmer. In the Demeter colorway. And it's actually got a green sparkle to it, and it's 63% silk, 23% kid mohair, 10% nylon, and 4% polyester. The polyester is the Stellina, the sparkly. So I was going to knit that into a beautiful, not knit, crochet into a beautiful shawl. I just haven't gotten that far, so. So stash enhancements, yes. So I guess I'm gonna start with the one that's in my hand. This was actually a Fiberista colorway that I got for June. And when I saw what it was, I squealed so hard because this was in my mailbox when I came home. And I just bought my very first skein out of that brand, leading up to getting this Fiberista. So I was so excited to get this. Oh, I don't know if I'm gonna knit it yet, but I love the colorway. Anyways, this is Hedgehog Fibers Hand-Dyed Yarn Sock Yarn Base in the Salty Tails colorway. The label, and this is the yarny goodness. It is a gray base with specks of turquoise, purple, magenta, orange, a little bit of brown. It's beautiful. And I follow Hedgehog Fibers on Instagram, and I have been dying for some of their yarn. And this is 100 grams or 400 meters of 90% superwash merino, 10% nylon. So it's a lot more wool content to fiber or wool to nylon. So it's definitely. So I might just make this into a fun pattern that I get from Fiberista. I've got quite a few sock patterns that I've gotten from them in the subscription box. So this is the same brand and base, Hedgehog Fibers. This was my very first skein of Hedgehog Fibers, and I actually got this in Oregon. I forget what store I got this in, but it was at the first one I got this from. The first store I went into, along with this yarn, and this is Three Irish Girls Yarn Ink. This is their new Adorn Luxe. It's 85% merino, 15% nylon, and the colorway is Cerossi, I guess. Beautiful aqua turquoise colors, and I thought that it would go well with this one, which is Nutmeg, and I love the teal turquoise fleck in it, and I just thought that they would complement each other well. And then I had grabbed this, which is a Madeline Tosh in the Twist Light, and this is the Coquette colorway. It's been discontinued, and I thought this would be a great complement to these three colors, or these two colors. And I was going to knit the Stephen West pattern. Oh, what was it? There was a lot of different techniques that I've never accomplished before, and I was nervous at first to do it, but now after watching some of the Stranded Dye Works podcast, I like her go-getter attitude when it comes to patterns, so I'm gonna attempt that. Ah, the doodler. That's it, the doodler shawl. It looks like a dragon wing to me. So if I were a dragon, these would probably be my colors. So, turquoise and pink. A lot of people would say that the pink doesn't naturally go with the turquoise, but if you know your color wheel, your color theory, that the blue and pink are almost on the opposite sides of the color wheel, so they complement each other very nicely. So that's those yarns. Another yarn that I'd gotten with in Oregon is another local hand-dyed yarn. This is the Thoroughly Thwacked company. This is the Abyss base, and the colorway is Bruised Fairy. I got this along with the gray and pink yarn. I wanted to get some Oregon hand-dyed, Pearl Fiber Arts Company. So, thoroughly thwacked. And it's actually really nice. It is a 50% merino, 50% silk. So I definitely want to use this for something more visible. I don't know if I want to wear it as a scarf or maybe some mitts. I think I'm going to knit this into some basic mitts. Just the traditional mitts. It does get kind of cold here up in Washington, so I don't have any mitts, so that'll definitely be useful. And these are colorways I would wear like that too. So I love bright colors. For those of you who don't know me, I absolutely love them. And then I think I showed this colorway to you guys already, but I brought this with me and it was in the bag, so I'm going to show it to you guys again. This is Sweet Georgia yarn in the Bulletproof sock. I did show this to you guys already, but I was going to make these into a pair of socks for my husband in a Riptide sock pattern. My Kindle is on the charger right now, so I can't necessarily grab it. So I didn't get to it because there was a few stitches that I just didn't know how to do, and I didn't have good enough internet service while I was out on overseas work. So wasn't able to look it up, so I didn't cast on those socks. And then my most recent yarn stash. No. And I showed you guys this guy. I needed to cast this on. It's for a hat for my husband. It is 100% silk. It's not the softest, but my husband wants a silk hat because he's silly. And he bought this yarn, so I can't tell him no. And it was quite expensive for 450 yards. It was like something like almost $40 for it, but it's pure silk, so that's why it's so expensive. Anyways, so now back to my most recent yarn purchase that just came in, that I just picked up yesterday. This guy's showing up a little bit blown out, but anyways, I'll pull it up closer. Oh no, it's showing up true to color on all three of those colors. All four of them. Well, except for the mare. So, I'm gonna grab the one that I went on to Jimmy Bean's Wool to see if they had this. And this is the mare colorway that I'm using on that shawl. I wanted an extra one so I wouldn't have to freak out about not having enough yarn for that shawl. Well, Jimmy Bean's Wool also offers free shipping when you spend $70 or more. And for those of you who don't know, but $70 spent on hand-dyed yarn doesn't go very far. But it can at the same time. But lately, this year, Madeline Tosh has actually done an exclusive year-long dye for Jimmy Bean's Wool, and they are based on the zodiac signs. So every month, she releases a new colorway in the zodiac signs. I've shown you January's, which was Aquarius, and that has been, I got it in the Dandelion base, which is their linen merino mixed base. It's a really pretty color of purple. They're more tonals. And I got three more. So I guess you could say I got the summer months. I got July, August, June, July, and August. Yeah, I did. I got all three summer months. So these are the summer colors. So this is Cancer. Beautiful, beautiful blues, and this is on the Tosh Merino White base, which is the 100% Merino. It's their singles. It's her singles base. I don't know what I'm going to knit this out of. I may just start ordering this yarn in larger quantities. It's only $22, so I may order each of the colors in larger quantities at a time. And knit sweaters out of these, because these would make amazing sweaters for both me and my husband. Actually, my husband would probably love this color. I would love to wear this color, actually. This is the Leo base, and this is my month Yas. Yas. I don't know what the Gemini color is. I do want to knit my husband a sweater out of that, so I may just order several skeins of that for him and knit him a sweater, probably for his birthday. So he loves hand knit stuff. That's why he encourages it. He buys me yarn. Babe, I want a new hat. And all of a sudden, there's yarn there for me. So I knit him a new hat. Or I knit him socks. Or in this case, I'm going to try and knit him a sweater. But I'm getting my own craft room so I can do that and not have him know that I'm knitting him a sweater for his birthday. And he doesn't watch this podcast, so I can talk about it without him knowing. Anyways, with that said, that is everything. Finished objects, works in progress, half-finished objects. No, I have two more stash enhancements. My two Fiberista bags from when I was overseas. My July and August bags came in. So, with that being said, I'm gonna go ahead and get into these. I don't know which ones are which. I don't have card for one of these bags. Yeah, for the black bag. So I apologize. I'm pretty sure I have August's bag though, or maybe I don't have the card for this month. I don't know. One of these. Yeah, I don't have the card for this month here. So, this is July's. So based on the stamp. And this is the Ba Yarn in Savannah base. That's her new tag, by the way. And this is the Orange Amber. It is 10% cashmere, 10% nylon, 80% superwash merino. And it is super soft. It's this beautiful color. So I told my husband I'd knit him some socks out of this color. He likes that idea. He does love this color. And as my bonus, I got a darning needle. Let's go ahead and take a look at that. I think I was opening it at one point and never finished opening it. I got distracted, I'm pretty sure, as usually is the case when it comes to this stuff. I think I decided I was going to wait until I can open it on the podcast with you guys. Yes. Oh, that's a pretty darning needle. Just blue metal. Regular darning needle, so I'll put that into my little darning needle container. So that's pretty. And these are soft. Ooh, this is soft. It's almost the same color. Yeah, it's the same color family. This is just a bit deeper. It does have those tones in it. There are some deeper tones that do match this colorway. But yeah, so. I'm not going to knit socks out of these because this is 100% merino and they won't hold up. But I'll definitely be saving that for something else. So that was that month. This is August's month. And I do have the card for this. September is on its way. I did get a tracking notice for it, so hopefully that'll be in the next podcast. So it says cats in pajamas. Welcome to August, Fiberistas. We've had a wonderful couple of months this summer, celebrating the warmer months of the year with some of our absolute favorite yarns. If you've been with us since June's shipment, we hope you're enjoying our hedgehog fibers and Brooklyn tweed yarny goodness. To kick off the change of the season, fall is coming. Really, what's not to love about the upcoming crisp weather paired with some wardrobe knitting? We're featuring an independent dyer this month with a unique eye for vibrant color and some of the softest merino we've ever laid our hands upon. The Cat's Pajamas is a yarn line that's as dear to our hearts as the dyer, Chastity, the color guru behind the line. It is a local member of the community, our yarn shop in Oak Park, Illinois. Chastity is a passionate fiber lover of all things yarn related, and you can really feel her passion in her devotion to color and lush yarn bases. For this month's sock yarn, we're featuring a scantilating base of 70% superwash merino and 30% silk. Our selected palette for the month includes 10 of our favorite colors for the upcoming fall season. This month's swag is a project bag to showcase your cat's pajamas love while you work with these wonderful yarns. This month's patterns will be released to all members via email on the 10th. So I already have my patterns and they're already downloaded. I've decided that I'm going to continue to download all of the patterns, or that is something I'm actually doing now. I'm downloading all of the patterns rather than just the ones that I initially like, because I'm finding that maybe my pattern choices are different than what other people would choose for their pattern choices. So, if I decide to gift a yarn or a project to somebody, I want to make sure I have a range of patterns. So here's the project bag. The cat's pajamas and this beautiful drawing of this she-cat. And this is the yarn right here. And these are my socks. These are my socks. Sorry, hubby. I love you, but these are mine. Look at that beautiful jade color. This is Ragdoll, 70% superwash merino and 30% silk. 440 yards, it's 100 grams, and the colorway is Emerald City. It's a single space. I just realized that. Holy cow. Wow, okay. So, yes, I want these on my feet. And I'm going to use one of the patterns that they gave me. Oh, there's a little extra twist there. Anyways, so I'm going to eventually get these on the needles. I still have the rest of September when I'm not moving, the rest of October when I'm not moving, November, and December. So I have about 3.5 months left to finish my box of socks cowl with Kristen, and I need a minimum of 12 socks. Right now, in hands, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, my husband's other pair, 6, and then I've got 3 pairs in my box, so I'm up to 9. So I am on track. Where's the sparkling ones? 10. I believe I'm on track and ahead of schedule. I wouldn't mind going over that many socks. That would be awesome if I could get more than 12 pairs of socks, because I want the whole box filled. Yeah. Oh, I forgot to show you guys this before I get into blather. I don't know how much time I have left on this, but I'm going to keep going because it hasn't flashed at me that my memory card is full yet, so. These. All of these. So this is a tea tin. We have a local lavender shop down in Coopville, which is about a 20-minute drive from my house, south of me. And I finished the tea. The tea was perfect if you love lavender tea, but I love the tin as well. So now this tin is being saved and used as my stitch marker / project keeper tin. And I have been on a project marker making frenzy lately. Actually, I wish I could show you my work area. If my husband saw it, he'd probably kill me because my beads are everywhere. And this is why I need a craft room, ladies and gentlemen. So I have made these. I've got some Lucky Cat ones. I have these two adorable ones that came in the same strand of beads, and they're little owls. I've got disco balls. Doo, 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 doo. I've got these I got a lot of these ones, these drop ones here. Now what's fun about these is I'm pretty much just using head pins now, which are these flat bottom ones. There, hide behind it. So yeah, those head pin ones. And I'm not using mini eye pins because I've learned how to make eye pins out of the scrap from the head pins. I've also learned how to make jump rings out of leftover scrap metal from the head pins. So that is a... Let's see if I can get that to focus. There we go. So this right here is a jump ring. And I've learned that's one of my own. One of the ones I've made. So a lot of my stitch markers here are completely, for the most part, using a lobster clasp, some beads, and head pins. Three items. That's it. Some of these have charms in them, so like this one here, this is one of my first sets that I started making. And I loved how these turned out. Those are adorable little moons. I've got two of those. And then I've got... those I've showed you before. What just fell? Oh, okay. We're good. Just some yarn. Made these little guys. So they're all fairly simple little sets. Turned the dangly bit into just a head pin or just a stitch marker itself. Love that. And I'm just using beads. Some of the beads I bought, you know, new strands of beads, but like the bigger ones, those are all kind of new strands, but I'm also using beads that are already in my stash. So I'm having so much fun making stitch markers. I've also been dyeing up yarn because I want to start a business dyeing my own yarns. So that's... I'm thinking that for a free gift for every time somebody purchases my yarn, for each skein, I'll just click on a little handmade project keeper onto the skein as well. So you'll get kind of like a bonus. I'll also probably be trying to... Sorry, I didn't mean to just bang that. I may also try and sell them individually or in pairs or something like that, if you wanted just like the stitch markers. So... but I'm not going to show any of the hand-dyed yarn. I haven't really solidified some things. I still want to work on labels. Once I have labels and a business plan thingy done, then I'll definitely start having like shop updates to show you guys and things like that. So that's going to be a new section. So yeah. I think we've kind of just wandered into blather, so I'm going to go ahead and go into that now, and I'm just going to pick up a project at hand. And I'm going to try and keep this under 15 minutes. So, let's start with the first thing. I already talked about what happened in the last few months, just kind of like an overview at the very, very beginning. So I'm going to go a little more in depth with it. So we went to Disneyland in June, at the beginning of June actually, and it was awesome. We took the train down and spent the night in Oregon, and we did some shopping. We learned a lot about each other, my husband and I, and did a lot of growth as a couple on that initial leg of the trip. We went to Disneyland, we saw the Getty Museum. We only saw a portion of it. We didn't even get to see all of the museum. We spent a day there. It was fabulous. Got to see some amazing art, some very famous art actually. We also got to see some amazing furniture from time periods long ago. The ingenuity and the craftsmanship of some of this work was just absolutely amazing. We went to the Chinese theater in Hollywood, and we saw the World of Warcraft movie. I'm a massive nerd. My husband encourages that. He's not quite such a nerd, but he's a nerd nonetheless. He enjoys sci-fi and things of that nature. That's his nerdy realm, whereas I'm more of a fantasy nerd. So we're kind of in the same genre, but not. It's like dogs or cats. We are animal people. We are cat and dog people. But whereas we both want dogs, he wants a small dog like a Pomeranian or a Corgi, and I want big dogs like a pit bull or a German Shepherd. So that's kind of like how our tastes are on nerdiness too. So he loves Star Trek, I'm Star Wars. We both love to read, but he reads fantasies and how-tos and self-helps, and his magazines are cooking related and mine are knitting related. So we're definitely two very individual people, but we love each other very much and we are trying very hard to create something together, as any couple really should. And this is probably my most challenging relationship ever. And I probably wouldn't change it for the world. I don't. That Disney trip really was either gonna make or break us. It really was. And it was our first time going out of our comfort zone, away from our home, and it was really nerve-wracking. And I don't want to go into too much personal detail because I know he doesn't like that, but honestly, I think it really did make us a lot more of a solid couple. And then we got home, and I got back to work. He got back to work. He was working on nights. I was working on days, so we didn't see each other much during the week. That caused some issues, some strain within the relationship, but we were still together. And then all of a sudden, it was like I blinked and I needed to get ready for my overseas travel. Everything happened to go there was crazy. It really, really, really was. It just happened in such a short period of time. All of a sudden, I needed to have my stuff packed, and I didn't even need to have the stuff. Like, I didn't have the money to even buy what I needed to, the extra stuff that I needed to have. So I had a mini meltdown at work. Thankfully, one of the guys at work he's done overseas work before on a couple of occasions, and he really, really helped to calm me down and solidify some things. As far as my relationship goes, while I was on that, I almost didn't come back married. I almost came back to a divorce. Sadly. And that also taught me that my relationship with my husband is more important to me than my individuality. I can still maintain who I am as a person. It also, we learned that our communication skills are absolutely horrible. Now, I already knew that my husband overthinks everything. Always. And I overthink everything. Always. And when you're sitting in a room and going from your bunk to work and then back to your bunk day in and day out for 6 weeks, you have a lot of time to think. And we both overthought what the other person was writing in emails way too much. So we were able to patch some things. I got home And once we've figured out some things, it got a lot better once I was home for sure. We knew that me going overseas was going to be a lot harder than him going overseas, because when he goes overseas with his current, gear, he still has internet, and I can still call him and Skype him and talk to him, and it's basically like we're just living in the same town, just in different homes, basically. So, I mean, I can't sleep next to him whenever I want, but, you know, it's like we're dating again, almost, just long distance. And while I don't mind it, it is hard physically on the relationship, but that's neither here nor there. All we had were emails, and I didn't always have internet service to even get an email out on most days. I'd actually lost my ID, so I couldn't even log onto a computer without permission from my boss, and I used his ID to log on, and and we had internet hours because there just wasn't enough bandwidth for everybody to be on all the time. So most times we were able to access work websites, but not personal websites, so like email and Facebook and all that jazz. So it was a really complicated 6 weeks for me. And then I got home and then we're like, let's buy a house! And so we are. So that's the biggest news. I'm getting my own craft room, guys. Oh, I'm so excited. So I went from that crazy, emotional, nerve-wracking time to a crazy, emotional, exciting, but still nerve-wracking time. I don't know how I'm dealing with all of this, but I am. It's making me sweaty, though. I just showered, too. Good thing we have deodorant, I guess. Ugh. Why is it so hot in here? I know why, and I'm looking at it, and it stinks. It needs its bed changed, actually. I was just looking at my hedgehog, for those of you who didn't know what I was looking at. It's incredibly hot in this room because of my hedgehog. It's like 76 degrees in this room. Ugh. That's American. It's like 20-something degrees Celsius? Don't quote me on that, though. I don't know my degrees, my Fahrenheit to Celsius conversions very well at all. But anyways, so now we're buying a house, and then I went to Camp Phoenix. And I absolutely love Camp Phoenix. Kathleen and Michael Mathis are absolutely amazing people, and Michael doesn't have children of his own. Kathleen, both of her kids have passed away to cancer. They love children, both of them, so much, and honestly, I would say that they've raised more children than any other person I've ever met. Because the children that they help care for, and I'm getting emotional, wow, it's like a family for them. They've watched these kids grow up. They've got kids that have been with them since they were 3 and 4 years old. And they're adults now. Like, one of the counselors they watched grow up, and he comes back every year to be a counselor, to give back what they gave him all those years. And he's a nurse now? Yeah, he's a nurse, and he's super tall, and he's super awesome. Like, all of the people there, the kids, the counselors, the staff, there is this overall feeling, like literally like a bubble of just generosity and kindness and love and acceptance. And just a true sense of family. The kind of family I wish I'd had my entire life. If I ever said I wanted to do something, and we were talking about what we're gonna do when we go home, because you're only there for a week, everyone's like, oh, that's awesome, good luck, if you need help, let me know, you know, just, and they do that for the kids too, like, we stay in contact with the kids, and we try and be, you know, their best cheerleaders for them, and all this other stuff, and I learned right then what I wanted, the kind of life I wanted to live, and I had experienced it pretty heavily last year. But this year, I took away a different sense of purpose from camp. Those kids. I mean, we'd have our afternoon snack and like ice cream or something like that. Like it was super hot and everybody was down by the water swimming or, you know, enjoying the breeze off the water, and the ladies in the kitchen who are awesome cooks, by the way. Big thumbs up for you ladies. Thank you so much for your wonderful cooking. But they brought us ice cream one day, and you know, I had a bowl and it was empty or just had the dregs of my ice cream and caramel in it. And one of the kids, like, he'd finished his and got, you know, threw away the trash, and he walked around and grabbed everybody's that was finished at the time and dropped them off. And then he did another round and picked up the second set of stuff. And he was just, it was so kind. And I don't experience that at work. And I hate that because I went and joined my company. You know, I asked to be a part of my company because I thought that was what I was getting. I thought I was getting a sense of community and friendship and support. And I really don't get that vibe very often. You know, when I came back from camp, anytime somebody had something negative said, you know, I was like, you know, I would just try and redirect. I was like, look, you can be miserable about this, but only you can change how miserable things are to you, or how miserable you are in reaction to things. Because we all know this stuff is going to happen. We all know that people are going to be grumpy and they're going to yell at us. But it is our reaction to the situation that's going to set the mood for the shop. So until we've chosen to change our actions and reactions, things aren't going to get better in the shop. And I was starting with the airmen. I was starting with the entry-level kids and the ones that are just moving through. And so I just trying to encourage more positive thinking, more positive reactions, trying to encourage solution-making thoughts rather than complaining thoughts. So it's taking work, and it makes me so upset. And I had an emotional breakdown with one of the buddies from work, who's been there for me before, for something very similar, and that's who got the Madeline Tosh sockhead beanie that I made in the purple. I bought that to make him a hat as just a thank you for his friendship, so, and for his kindness. And so I wanted to repay his kindness back. And he loves it. My water bottle! I wanted something that wasn't quite so sweet as my coffee. And my coffee's almost gone anyways. So this was a water bottle that they gave all of us at Camp Phoenix with our backpacks this year. My husband grilled me about it. He's like, where'd you get that water bottle? I was like, it came in my backpack for camp. He's like, what? And I showed him. He's like, that's awesome. I was like, It was a really hot summer this year too, so we really encouraged the hydration, and it was really easy to stay hydrated because we're like, where's your water bottle? I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? You better find it. Better find it now. Or you're not doing whatever activity we're about to go do. And then I was like, to the girls on my camera, I was like, or you can take a ride with Heather to the hospital. They're like, what? Why would I do that? I was like, because if you're dehydrated, that you pass out, you're going to the hospital to get fluids through an IV. And Heather's the nurse, so have fun with that. They're like, no, I don't need to go to the hospital. Please don't stick me in a car with her. It's like, you'll be passed out, you'll be fine. You won't even notice. So, she's actually a really awesome person. She just, she's kind of a mommy figure. And, well, you need to do this, and you need to do that, and don't do that, that kind of a mommy. Kind of like a helicopter mom, kind of, but not really. So, but anyways, she's also a lot of fun too. I was so excited to see her at camp, but when I saw her name in the email list, I was like, yes, so excited. So we were in the cabins together, and we slept in the same bed. So we're no, she slept in the single bed next to me. So that was Ivy last year. But anyways, so Anne and Zizi, the other counselor that was in the cabin, slept in the bunk beds where Heather slept last year. So anyways, so I had three girls this year. I had 2 15-year-olds and a 9-year-old. 15-year-olds, super easy. They're big girls. Just kinda had to make sure they told me where they were going, when they were going places. I didn't really see one of them. She made a boyfriend at camp, and so I noticed from the first day that she wasn't kind of one of those big, like she wasn't gonna go do something stupid, if you catch my drift. While at camp, she wasn't gonna sneak off and do things that she shouldn't be doing at 15, but we all know 15-year-olds try to do. My other one made a friend with one of the girls from the older girl cabin, so I know she always had a buddy, and my 9-year-old, I introduced to one of the counselors' daughters. He's got a 7-year-old and a 4-year-old, and his 7-year-old and my 9-year-old became the best of friends ever. And so I always knew those two were safe if they weren't running to the 7-year-old's dad. They were hanging out with me in the cabin. So, or, you know, they were always making sure that they made it. So his daughter ended up, you know, wanting to have sleepovers with my 9-year-old, which was fine because the bunk right next to my 9-year-old was open. So we took on an extra girl. There were 17 of us in the cabin this year. It's a lot of people. The cabin holds 20, so there's three open bunks. So we were kind of pushing it with bodies there. So there weren't enough mattresses actually. And the reason why is because the mattresses they have in those cabins suck. And so girls were doubling up the mattresses just to have some cushion. Actually, one of the 15-year-olds that I get along with very well, she and I are very close, she woke up bawling her eyes out. Her back hurt so bad. And she actually ended up crawling into bed with me just so that she had something comfortable to lay on. I had actually just gotten back home from my overseas travel, and that mattress was 100 times harder than any of those mattresses in the cabin. So I was perfectly fine. I was sore, but I was fine. So she crawled into bed with me for about 30 minutes, 30 to 45 minutes, just trying to relax. And then she went canoeing. Got up at 4 with Heather and went canoeing. She got some medicine, and then she spent the rest of the morning, like, she tried really hard to be active in the morning, and then she just couldn't, like, she just didn't have it in her to be active anymore, and she ended up laying down on the sidelines during Zumba, because we have one of the staff members is a Zumba instructor, so she taught a Zumba class with the kids. So that was fun, but she couldn't stay in it. She couldn't participate, the camper couldn't participate in Zumba, and she tried. She got some more meds later on. She tried to get, you know, tried to get more help than what she was getting, and no one was really listening to her. But there's only so much we can do with over-the-counter stuff, and unless she wanted to go to the hospital, we really couldn't do anything for her, and she didn't want to go to the hospital, so. With that said, she is a super sweet girl, and she's supposed to hopefully come up and help me move in a couple of weeks. I don't know. I don't know when. Not when. I don't know if she can. She's gonna try. Sorry, I was looking up something. I need to message her actually later and see if she's going to be able to have me pick her up after school at Friday so she can come help me move. And if not, that's fine. I won't have to waste 6 hours of driving. I can use it for moving. So, and anyways, because she does live quite a bit further south of me. But hopefully, I was also thinking about making a day trip with my mother-in-law, because I don't work Fridays. I don't work Friday or Saturday. That's my weekend. So I was thinking about maybe having my mother-in-law and I go down early in the morning and get my table and the legs, what I'm going to be using as legs, which are just from IKEA, and then go and get my little camper for the weekend while we're down there, since IKEA's down south for me anyways, so that would be a good day trip. And I'm supposed to have my roommate home, and my roommate's girlfriend is supposed to be here too, I don't like her. I don't like my roommate's girlfriend. So, I need to be out of the house, basically. So that is everything. And I think this episode's like 2 hours long, because I started at 11:30 and it's now 1:10. Hopefully I'll have this up and edited. I'm going to try and put show notes for this. I couldn't exactly find all of the labels, so it may take me a couple of days. I may just post portions of it at a time, and then update it as I find stuff. I can't promise anything. Sorry, guys. So I know I'm going to be writing the Ravelry page as I edit this episode, so what else? I can't think of anything else. So don't forget to check me out on Ravelry there. I am Crafty Cassie there on Ravelry. And the group is the Wip It podcast. It is a picture of my hedgehog. Because I'm in the process of starting my own business, hopefully I will get the JPEG for my business cards. And if that's the case, then I will use that, because that's hopefully going to be my logo. I may find somebody on Etsy. If you know somebody who knows how to make clip art or stuff like that to insert into things like that, I would love to get in contact with you. and see what you can do with my idea. Or rather, send me links to check out your work so that I can see if it's maybe the aesthetic that I want. And I go from there. So I think until next time, guys, I will see you later. Don't forget to finish all your whips. I love you guys.